Physiology.
So very much welcome to this class, whereby in this class we are going to discuss about cell physiology. So what is cell physiology? So simply, cell physiology, this is the study of the cell functions. So in cell physiology, we study how the cell functions at different rates or at different modes. So you see that materials do move in and out of the cell. So for materials to move in and out of the cell, there must be a cell membrane or a plasma membrane to regulate this movement. So briefly, let's look at that cell membrane that we're talking about. So this cell membrane, you see that it is made up of two main layers, whereby the first layer is the protein layer and the second layer is the phospholipid layer. Now, as you can see in the diagram, the protein layer is always surrounded by the phospholipid layer, whereby the phospholipid layer is located on the upper and the lower parts of the cell membrane, and the protein layer is always located at the central part of the cell membrane. So let's now look at the properties of cell membrane. Yeah. So what are the properties of cell membrane? So first of all, we see that the cell membrane is semi-permeable, meaning that it can only allow some materials to enter and not others. So you see that the cell membrane is also sensitive to temperature and pH, whereby high temperatures will destroy the cell membrane. Very low temperatures will inactivate the cell membrane, therefore meaning that the cell membrane won't be inactive. So the physiological processes of the cell membrane would take place if the temperatures are too low. So we also see that the cell membrane has electric charges, that is the positive terminal and the negative side, not really terminal, but these charges. So what are the functions of the electric charges? So these electric charges are the ones which determine which materials will enter the cell and which materials will not enter into the cell. Then finally, we see that the cell membrane is sensitive to pH, whereby if the pH is too acidic, it will destroy the cell membrane. If the pH is too basic, it will again destroy the cell membrane. So the cell membrane works best at optimum pH. Let's look at now the different physiological processes that we have. So we see that movement of materials in and out of the cell mainly takes place or mainly occurs through these physiological processes. So the first physiological process to look at is diffusion, then we are going to look at osmosis, and then finally we are going to look at active transport. So what is diffusion? So diffusion in definition will say that this is the movement of particles or molecules from a region of high concentration to a region of low concentration. So if materials move from a region of high concentration to a region of low concentration, that is diffusion. You should also know that diffusion mostly occurs in liquids and gases only. It does not occur in solids. So it occurs in only liquids and gases. So what is diffusion at concentration gradient? So you say that this is the difference in concentration between two points that diffusion physiological process is occurring. So maybe in part A and part B, if the diffusion in part A is 5 moles and part B is 2 moles, so the difference in diffusion here will be 3. So that is the diffusion or the concentration gradient. It's just the difference in the concentration between two points under which diffusion is taking place. So what are the factors affecting diffusion? So the first factor affecting diffusion is concentration gradient. Again, in the experiment, if part A, the concentration is 5 moles, and part B, the concentration is 2 moles, so the diffusion gradient here will be 3 moles. That's the difference. So let's look at another experiment below it. So if the concentration of part C is 10 moles and part D is 3 moles, so the difference in diffusion is 7. So it means that part AB, the diffusion, the concentration gradient is only 3. While in the next experiment, the concentration is 7. So in the second experiment, that is part C and D, so the diffusion process will occur rapidly because the diffusion gradient is too large. The diffusion gradient or the concentration gradient. So the other factor affecting diffusion is size of the particles, whereby larger particles diffuse slowly as compared to very tiny particles, which diffuse faster. Also, the other factor is thickness of the membrane. So very thin membrane diffusion will be rapid. Very thick membrane diffusion will proceed very slowly. So the other will have temperature. So under optimum temperature, diffusion will be rapid. Under very low temperature, diffusion will happen very slowly. So the next one is surface area to volume ratio. So the larger the surface area to volume ratio, the larger the rate of diffusion. The lower the surface area to volume ratio, the lower the rate of diffusion. So this experiment is always demonstrated by using a rat which has a high surface area to volume ratio as compared to a dog, whereby in the topic of respiration we are going to look at this even more. So let's look at the roles of diffusion in plants and animals. So let's begin with plants. So diffusion in plants is very essential because it facilitates the absorption of water and mineral salts from the soil into the root. Also, transport of manufactured food substances in the phloem occurs through the physiological process, which is diffusion. Not to forget removal of excess water through transpiration and gases exchange, which involves absorption of oxygen for respiration and carbon dioxide for photosynthesis. So let's again look at now diffusion, the roles of diffusion in animals. So in animals, we see that there's the absorption of food from the ileum. We also have reabsorption of mineral ions from the kidney. Example, we have the chlorine and the sodium ions. We also have excretion of nitrogenous waste and gases exchange, whereby oxygen diffuses across the respiratory surface into the bloodstream, as now the carbon dioxide diffuses out of the body. So this process proceeds through a physiological process, that is diffusion. So lastly, let's look at the experiments to demonstrate diffusion. So the two main experiments we are going to look at. So first experiment we're going to look at we are going to demonstrate it using potassium permanganate crystals, which are purple in color. So if you take a beaker full of water and then you drop the potassium permanganate crystal, so soon the potassium permanganate crystal will start dissolving gradually in the water in the beaker. So this is a very common experiment to demonstrate diffusion. Also, using potassium permanganate, we may use a straw, and then we take that straw, we hold it down on the beaker, and then inside the straw we add some amount of potassium permanganate. Now in the beaker we add water. So this experiment demonstrates diffusion in that after some time we remove the straw and the potassium permanganate will be contact with the water. So the area on the potassium permanganate will be highly concentrated and the water molecules are lowly concentrated. So the potassium permanganate that is highly concentrated will soon start dissolving into the water and trying to occupy the areas that is lowly concentrated. So that is another experiment to demonstrate diffusion. So the last experiment to demonstrate diffusion, we are going to look at the perfume or a perfume in a room. Now, if one person sprays perfume on one corner of the room, so the other person on the other corner of the room will soon start to smell also the same perfume. This is a reason to explain diffusion in that the area that the perfume was sprayed became highly concentrated. Now, the perfume traveled occupying the areas that were slowly concentrated in the room. Therefore, after a short while, the whole room will start to smell the perfume. So those are experiments to demonstrate diffusion. So let's meet now in the next class as we now look on osmosis. Biology.